Good morning.
Good morning.
We welcome all of you on this special Sunday, Trinity Sunday. So, an answer to prayer to have all of you with us on this special Memorial Day weekend. With it being Trinity Sunday, our theme is Our Triune God Loves Us. And we begin then with hymn 189, Jehovah, Let Me Now Adore You, 189. Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
We have come into the presence of God, who created us to love and serve him as his dear children, but we have disobeyed him and deserve only his wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to him and plead for his mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to his will.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Saving grace through our Lord Jesus Christ. In mercy, cleanse our hearts and lips that, free from doubt and fear, we may ever worship you, one true, immortal God, with your Son and the Holy Spirit, living and reigning, now and forever. Our scripture reading this morning is recorded for us in the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 6, beginning with verse 1. It will also serve as our sermon text for this morning. The words are printed in our worship folders if you'd enjoy following along. In the year that King Uzziah died, Isaiah, of course, saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each one had six wings. With two, they covered their faces. With two, they covered their feet. With two, they flew. One called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of armies," which could also be translated, "Jehovah of the heavenly hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The foundation of the threshold shook at the voice of the one who called, and the temple was filled with smoke. Then I said, "I am doomed. I am ruined, because I am a man with unclean lips, and I dwell among a people with unclean lips, and because my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of armies." Then one of the seraphim flew to me, carrying a glowing coal in his hand, which he had taken from the altar with tongs. He touched my mouth with the coal and said, "Look, this has touched your lips, so your guilt is taken away, and your sin is forgiven." Then I heard the Lord's voice saying, "Whom shall I send? Who will go for us?" Then I said, "Here I am, send me." This is the word of the Lord. We invite the congregation to turn to Psalm 150 in the front of the hymnal, page 122. Psalm 150 is a psalm of praise that honors our God for the great things he has done. And of course, the psalmist urges us to use every instrument we have and to praise him with everyone who has breath. Psalm 150, page 122. The love of our triune God is for us. The Holy Spirit leading us as children of God, bringing us to faith in Jesus, and because of Jesus' work, we can call God Father in the most tender and close sense of that word. Indeed, those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery so that you are afraid again, but you received the spirit of adoption, by whom we call out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself joins our spirit in testifying that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, we are also heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, since we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. This is the word of the Lord. Alleluia. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. Alleluia.
Thank you.
Gospels recorded for us in John's Gospel, chapter 3, beginning with verse 1. And when we were baptized is when we were adopted into God's family. This is brought out here in this text. And note all the other ways in which the love of our triune God is brought out. Out of respect and love and honor for our Savior, we invite the congregation to arise. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these miraculous signs you are doing unless God is with him." Jesus replied, "Amen, amen. I tell you, unless someone is born from above, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? He cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born, can he?" Jesus answered, "Amen, amen. I tell you, unless someone is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Whatever is born of the flesh is flesh. Whatever is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not be surprised when I tell you that you must be born from above. The wind blows where it pleases. You hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." "How can these things be?" asked Nicodemus. "You are the teacher of Israel," Jesus answered. "And you do not know these things? Amen, amen, I tell you, we speak what we know, and we testify about what we have seen. But you people do not accept our testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man, who is in heaven. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." Here ends our gospel reading. And at this time, once a year, of course, on Trinity Sunday, we confess the Athanasian Creed. Because of the length of it, the congregation may be seated. The Athanasian Creed is found on page 132 in the front of our hymnal. Page 132. And I will read the introduction to the Athanasian Creed, and then the congregation is invited to confess it with me. And I should just give you this heads up, the very last couple sentences you might think that it's promoting salvation by works, but let's keep in mind that without faith, it's impossible to please God. So we're confessing our faith, and then this passage reminds us how important it is to show that that faith is alive by our works. So the introduction, page 132. This creed is named after Saint Athanasius, a staunch defender of the Christian faith in the 4th century. It was prepared to assist the church in combating two errors that undermine Bible teaching. One error denied that God's Son and the Holy Spirit are of one being or Godhead with the Father. The other error denied that Jesus Christ is true God and true man in one person. The Athanasian Creed continues to serve the Christian church as a standard of the truth. It declares that whoever rejects the doctrine of the Trinity and the doctrine of Christ is without the saving faith. Please join me. Whoever wishes to be saved must, above all else, hold to the true Christian faith. Whoever does not keep this faith pure in all points will certainly perish forever. Now this is the true Christian faith. We worship one God in three persons, and three persons in one God, without mixing the persons or dividing the divine being. For each person, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, is distinct, but the deity of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is one, equal in glory and co-eternal in majesty. What the Father is, so is the Son, and so is the Holy Spirit. The Father is uncreated, the Son uncreated, the Holy Spirit uncreated. The Father is infinite, the Son infinite, the Holy Spirit infinite. The Father is eternal, the Son eternal, the Holy Spirit eternal. Yet they are not three who are eternal, but there is one who is eternal. Just as they are not three who are uncreated, nor three who are infinite, but there is one who is uncreated, and one who is infinite. In the same way, the Father is almighty, the Son is almighty, the Holy Spirit is almighty. Yet they are not three who are almighty, but there is one who is almighty. So the Father is God, the Son is God, the Holy Spirit is God. Yet they are not three gods, but one God. So the Father is Lord, the Son is Lord, the Holy Spirit is Lord. Yet they are not three lords, but one Lord. For just as Christian truth compels us to confess each person individually to be God and Lord, so the true Christian faith forbids us to speak of three gods or three lords. The Father is neither made nor created nor begotten of anyone. The Son is neither made nor created, but is begotten of the Father alone. The Holy Spirit is neither made nor created nor begotten, but proceeds from the Father and the Son. So there is one Father, not three fathers, one Son, not three sons, one Holy Spirit, not three Holy Spirits. And within this Trinity, none comes before or after, none is greater or inferior, but all three persons are co-equal and co-eternal. So that in every way, as stated before, all three persons are to be worshipped as one God, and one God worshipped as three persons. Whoever wishes to be saved must have this conviction of the Trinity. It is furthermore necessary for eternal salvation truly to believe that our Lord Jesus Christ also took on human flesh. Now this is the true Christian faith. We believe and confess that our Lord Jesus Christ, God's Son, is both God and man. He is God eternally begotten from the nature of the Father, and he is man born in time from the nature of his mother, fully God, fully man, with rational soul and human flesh, equal to the Father as to his deity, less than the Father as to his humanity. And though he is both God and man, Christ is not two persons, but one. One not by changing the deity into flesh, but by taking the humanity into God. One indeed, not by mixture of the natures, but by unity in one person. For just as the rational soul and flesh are one human being, so God and man are in one Christ. He suffered for our salvation, descended into hell, rose the third day from the dead. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and from there will come to judge the living and the dead. At his coming, all people will rise with their own bodies to answer for their personal deeds. Those who have done good will enter eternal life, and those who have done evil will go into eternal fire. This is the true Christian faith. Whoever does not faithfully and firmly believe this cannot be saved. We continue then with our next hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy is the Lord God Almighty. Spirit, Amen. As we noted, the word of our God, which we're pondering together today, is given for us in the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 6, beginning with verse 1. Let's read together the last verse in that section. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me, send me." In the name of the true triune God, the only God who saves, my dear friends, have you made a plan to see some sights this summer, maybe on an upcoming vacation? My wife and I are looking forward to later on this summer, heading out to Colorado. Two of our sons are out there and their families, and so we're wondering what kinds, they always send us such neat pictures. So we're wondering what sights they're going to take us to see. And if you're going to see some neat sights and you don't mind sharing it, I'd enjoy hearing about it following the service. And speaking of awesome sights that we can see right here in our own country, sometimes in our own backyards, what an awesome sight we saw last Sunday through the eyes of the prophet Ezekiel. We witnessed a tremendous miracle, a valley filled with dry bones, and the Holy Spirit brought these bones together and brought them back to life again. Picture of the awesome work of the Holy Spirit who can take people dead in sin and bring them to life by bringing them to faith in Jesus our Savior. And today, dear friends, we have an even more spectacular sight to see through the eyes of the prophet Isaiah, to see God himself on his throne. So let's see, based on these beautiful words before us, what an awesome triune God we have. First of all, ponder his glory and then treasure his grace. Verse 1 says, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord." Now, King Uzziah is the 10th king there in the southern kingdom of Judah. And we're told by the Bible scholars that he died in the year 742 B.C. In the first verse of Isaiah's book, he tells us that he served during the reigns of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, these kings of Judah. And Hezekiah died in about 690 B.C., which tells us that Isaiah had the honor, the blessing of serving the Lord, serving God's people, for like 50 years. That is totally awesome, especially when you think of the people to whom he was sharing the word of God. He says it this way about the culture of his day. In chapter 5 of Isaiah, verse 20, "Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter." And if you care to read chapter 5 when you get home later on today, you'll see one woe after the other that he's addressing to God's people who are not listening and are not repenting, primarily because of the false gods that they are serving. We go back to our text. So praise the Lord for this faithful prophet who did not ever stop sharing the truth. So he saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Dear friends, we've got to use our imagination here. I looked on Google Images. There's not one image where an artist tried to bring out the majesty of our one true God, whose robe of his, the train of his robe fills the temple. Now, keep in mind, this isn't the temple on earth. This is a temple in heaven. And so it's a majestic sight here. Isaiah is seeing the Lord in his majesty, the greatness of our triune God. And above him, to add to the majesty, above him were seraphs. Now notice, we're familiar with the word seraphim. See, that's right from the Hebrew. That's the plural for more than one seraph. This translation uses the English plural, seraph. perhaps we prefer what's in our hymnal and in a number of places and so on. There were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings, they covered their faces. With two, they covered their feet. And with two, they were flying. Here's one attempt of an artist to try to display what Isaiah got to see. What's not so important to know what it looked like is more important of what this is meaning. Think of it, dear friends. These are holy angels. Never a flaw on their record. And here, with two wings, they're covering their faces, and two, they're covering their feet, demonstrating humility, demonstrating reverence in the presence of our awesome triune God. Isn't this eye-opening when you think of so many people on this earth thinking their good works can get them to heaven, when holy angels have to cover their faces in God's presence? It underscores what we hear from God's lips to Moses, who wanted to look at God. But God said, "You cannot see my face, for no one may see me and live." No one. Only believers in the one true God can. And isn't it neat how the hymn writer of one of our most familiar hymns, Beautiful Savior, catches this idea. Fair is the sunshine, fair is the moonlight, bright the sparkling stars on high. Jesus shines brighter, Jesus shines purer than all the angels in the sky. How glorious, how majestic our triune God is. And then, once again, to illustrate God's great power is the power of the angels, the seraphim. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." Holy, holy, holy. Flawless. Pure. Undefiled. Never makes a mistake. Never blows his stack. What an awesome triune God, emphasized three times. Why three times? We all know. Triune God. And this is common throughout the whole book of Isaiah. The number three, over and over and over again. Is the Lord Almighty. Perhaps you remember that word Lord in all capital letters can be translated Jehovah. Better, Yahweh, so holy that the devout Jews will never say it, not even to this day. So thus the English translators following that custom. And the more important thing is the meaning of God's name in Exodus 34, 6 and 7. This is the only God who forgives iniquity, transgression, and sin, because the Son of God was lifted up like the snake in the desert by Moses. The Lord Almighty. Did you catch it in our scripture reading from the Evangelical Heritage Version? It's translated the Lord of Armies. Of course, the word armies is capitalized. There we need to think of not armies as pertaining to this earth, but the heavenly armies. All of the seraphim and all of the cherubim, which are the guardian angels that watch over us here on earth. By the way, seraphim, this is the only place in the Bible where that word is found. That rank of angels serving before God's face. So, the word Almighty comes from the first translation of the Hebrew text. It comes from, perhaps you remember the name of the first translation. It's the Greek translation called the Septuagint. So they put the word all-powerful in there. And I like that translation, the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. So in other words, dear friends, you see, God's glory is everything we know about him. And we can learn a lot about God and His glory just by looking around us, can't we? If you go out to visit the mountains, how majestic they are. How majestic is our God. The beautiful flowers that we get to see, how kind our God is to bless us with such beauty. Just think, here on earth can be so beautiful. How beautiful it must be in heaven. And of course, we, many of us live in the country. Perhaps you think what I think when we get to drive here to Emmanuel from Fort Atkinson to see the fields planted, and when God has watered the fields and the fields are all growing and green. That displays God's glory, doesn't it? He's blessing our farmers and blessing all of us through our farmers. But of course, the greatest aspect of God's glory is what we get to see a cross like we have at the top of our steeple or wherever it might be on display. And that reminds us, for the wages of sin is death, but what love our triune God has for us. The gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. What an awesome triune God. What a privilege for you and me to view His glory through the eyes of Isaiah today. And the powerful angels, underscoring God's power. Do you remember what just the words of the holy angels accomplished? Causing the doorposts and the threshold of the temple to tremble. So just the words from the angels, and think of how powerful the Word of God is to continue to bless us with a faith that's growing. And so ponder His glory, treasure His grace. What's Isaiah's response to this display of glory and power? Woe is me, I cried. I am ruined, for I'm a man of unclean lips, and I live among the people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. He's afraid he's going to die. He remembers those words you and I reviewed already. Woe, woe to me. Dear friends, do we sometimes react this way to our holy God? In ways that's good. It's good for us to realize, like we've already confessed together, we've sinned. We're a people of unclean lips at times, right? Even though we praise God with our lips, sometimes from our lips comes things that should not come from our lips, sinful things. Maybe sometimes we forget God is holy. He knows what He's doing. Not even a sparrow falls to the ground without Him knowing it. He knows where we're at. And sometimes maybe from our lips comes questioning. Where does God really care? Where is God? Why isn't He answering my prayers right away? I'd like to have answers right now. And so maybe we doubt His holiness. He's got a plan for us, and it's going to be good. But we need to remember what the psalmist reminds us in Psalm 27, verse 14. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. He's our Father, remember? He loves us far more than even a loving earthly father. And just think what He did so that He could have us call Him Father and know how great this is love. First of all, go back to our text. Then one of the seraphs flew to me, and a live coal, with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. Remember what happens at the altar? The innocent animals die, representing the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. So the blood had fallen on that coal. He took one of those coals, and with it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." What great news! And of course, this represented the Lamb of God. How our triune God loves us. The hand representing God the Father, the hand that protects us, the hand that opens up and provides us with all that we need, the hand that said to his son, go, descend to earth, ascend on that cross, pay the price so that I can adopt sinners as saints in heaven as my children. And there's the Lamb, Jesus. How great is his love that he would be willing to carry out that plan, die on that cross, rise again, so we can be sure what the angel spoke to Isaiah, God himself speaks to you and me. Our lips are cleansed. Our guilt is gone. Every sin erased by the blood of the Lamb. And of course, it would all be meaningless, dear friends, but for the Holy Spirit, the dove who brought Jesus into our hearts when we were baptized and who has not stopped working so that that faith doesn't die but keeps on growing stronger as we continue in the Word of God and continue receiving the sacrament, bringing us blessings that no money can buy. Here's the, I don't know if you can see the seven little flames underneath the dove, representing Isaiah 11, verse 2, the sevenfold gifts of the Spirit, wisdom and understanding, power and knowledge, the fear of the Lord, the Holy Spirit resting on us. There's counsel in there as well. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And I said, here am I. Send me. Dear friends, isn't this something what the gospel does? What the good news of Jesus and his love does? It replaced fear with joy. It replaced, I can't do anything. I'm woe to me, with, here am I, send me. Dear friends, has this message touched our hearts? Are we ready to be an Isaiah when the Lord needs your hands, needs your heart, needs your lips? Maybe with someone who's sick and needs a word of encouragement or some help of some kind. Or maybe a family member or a neighbor who desperately needs Jesus. How are they going to hear without someone speaking to them? The Lord wants to use our lips. Or maybe there's a person with a heavy-duty challenge, going through some of those heavy-duty trials in life. I mean, life can be hard for you and me, God's people, who can trust in the Lord no matter what. Have a heart for those who don't have the Lord. And they go through the same things, only it can be devastating. It can mean sometimes even suicide. That's how important your work and mine are, to be willing to say when the Lord is directing us. And maybe it's some work here at church. Whatever needs to be done. Are we ready? Here am I. Send me. So what an awesome triune God we have. What a God of love. Ponder his glory. And of course, the greatest glory is at the cross and the empty tomb. Treasure his grace. Let's respond like Isaiah. Here am I, send me. Amen. And the peace of God, which is beyond our dreams, shall guard and keep our hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. So at this time, the offering for the Lord will be gathered and will be brought for the Lord's work here at Emmanuel. We're so grateful to God for many guests with us. It's not necessary for you to participate in the offering. God bless all of you. Almighty and everlasting triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we thank you that you have revealed yourself to us in your holy word as the one and only true and living God. Without this revelation of you, we would be ignorant of you and would become guilty of worshiping some false god. Help us, like Nicodemus of old, diligently to seek after the truth, that we may know more about you, your will, and your marvelous dealings with people. Grant unto us and unto our children the new birth through holy baptism. Renew us by your Spirit, so that we may be heirs of everlasting life. Keep us ever mindful of how our blessed Savior was lifted up on the cross of Calvary for our sins, and let the remembrance of this move us to dedicate ourselves to you, both body and soul, and willingly and joyfully say with Isaiah, when there are opportunities to serve you, here am I, send me. Hear us, O God the Father who made us, God the Son who redeemed us, and God the Holy Spirit who has renewed us. And Heavenly Father, with it being Memorial Day, we pray on this day, at this time, as we set aside a moment to honor those who have died in the service of our great country, O God. We thank you for giving such patriotic citizens and a country that chooses to remember them. And at this time, too, we think of loved ones, near and dear ones, saints in the Lord Jesus who have gone to their homes. We pray, Lord, that you would give us your Holy Spirit so that we would imitate those saints who labored so hard in the past and who have passed on wonderful examples, models of people who have loved the Lord, and grant us the strength to put those things into practice, praising you, O Savior, in your eternal glory. And with the Lakeside graduation today and the Luther Prep graduation yesterday, we pray, Lord, for those students as well as for all students who, if they haven't graduated already, will be graduating soon. We pray, Lord, Heavenly Father, thank you for blessing these gifted young people with achieving these milestones in their lives. And we pray, Lord, that you would go with them. Grant that they would realize that those wonderful gifts they've been using don't just happen. They came from you, Lord. Move them and all of us to praise you, for we are fearfully and wonderfully made. And most importantly, Lord, use them as your lips and use their lives to your glory, so that through their labors, whichever way you are leading them, they will honor and glorify you, that they might be Bibles that other people can read and learn not only of your glory, but of your infinite love. And those who are going out and are not Christians, help them to have open ears and open eyes when they see people living their Bibles and people speaking the truth in love. And we pray, Lord, for near and dear ones. First of all, we pray for Kim Roberts' uncle, who is dying of cancer at the Vets Hospital. Pour out your Holy Spirit on him and grant him the comfort of knowing that the Savior died to save him too. Grant him your Holy Spirit so that he is comforted with that good news. Grant that same comfort to Dean Walter, who is recovering at the Oak Park Rehabilitation Center. Graciously be with him, Lord, because they have the stipulation that no one can visit him there. Help him to look to you for the help he needs and help him to remain confident of the love of our true triune God. Lord, thank you for hearing our prayers and blessing Wayne Martin, who who is doing better and is back at Alden Estates now. Continue to bless him there. Graciously, Lord, hear our prayer. Restore his health and his strength, and use this trial, Lord, to draw this devout man of God ever closer to you by faith. We bring all of these requests and our thanks and praise to you, Lord, in Jesus' name. In his name we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The congregation may be seated as we continue with our next hymn, 193, Come Now, Almighty King, 193. Keep us strong in your grace and truth. Protect and comfort us in all temptation, and bestow on us your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another. Serve the Lord with gladness. And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Sunday school also is postponed at this time. 2 o'clock this afternoon is the Lakeside graduation, if that would be of interest to you folks. And it being Memorial Day weekend, we have the custom of having the ammo can door offering. This is for veterans and their families who are in need in our from our faith and from our sister synod, the ELS. Backside of our worship folders lists how those gifts will be used. And I think a big thing is, as perhaps all of you realize, those who have seen active service come home with a lot of baggage often called PTSD. And I read a book about that, and I don't want to ever experience it. I want to help them. So if you'd like to do the same, that will be there as well as for their families. Some families fall apart because the service person comes home with PTSD and they don't know how to cope with the issues. So this is not only for the servicemen, but also for their families who may be in need. And if you'd like to read an insert talking about Memorial Day and its meaning, we had this insert last Sunday. We have a couple bulletins from last Sunday there in the track rack as you leave. God be with all of you, and bless you with the guardian angels if you're traveling this Memorial Day weekend, and God be with you till we meet again. Again, a special welcome to our guests. So wonderful to have you with us. God bless you. Goodbye, everyone.